and the questions asked is totally based on the concept. So the questions are very simple if you just go through the concepts once. So we'll study this electromagnetics. We'll start from the basics, because the electromagnetic basics is some mathematical tools like coordinate system, vector calculus. So first we will start with the coordinate system. So what is a coordinate system? Coordinate system is nothing but just to represent any point, or you can say it's a way of addressing any point in the space. So any point in the space, how to address that point? We can address that point because it is a space is 3D, three dimensional, right? So we required three variables. We will be required three variables. So to represent any point in the space, we will requiring three variables. So coordinate system can be of, it depends which reference you are assuming. So if we assume Cartesian coordinate system, there are three types of coordinate system: Cartesian coordinate system, cylindrical coordinate system, spherical coordinate system. It will depend on the situation, which of this coordinate system to be used at which place. So if you are having some rectangular sheet, if you want to calculate the electric field or any quantity due to a rectangular sheet, because the rectangular sheet is having symmetry with respect to Cartesian coordinate system, that is a rectangular coordinate system, x, y, z. So we will represent any point on the rectangular sheet with respect to the Cartesian coordinate system. If we have any line, infinite length line carrying current wire, we need to calculate some magnetic field intensity, then we will use cylindrical coordinate system, because line is always has symmetry with respect to cylinder. So we will use cylindrical coordinate system. Similarly, spherical coordinate system, if we have a point in the space, any charge point, any q charge is placed at particular point, the symmetry around it will be spherical in nature. Electric field at every point on the sphere, on the surface of sphere, will be same, right, at equidistance from the charge, because all the points are at equidistance. So it will form a symmetry in spherical coordinate system. So based on the symmetry, actually we will apply the coordinate system, which coordinate system to be used when. And all these coordinate systems follow two properties. One is orthogonality and other is orthonormality. What is orthogonality and orthonormality? We will see. First, let me share the screen with you. I will show you the, just a second. Yes, hope you can see the screen now. So yes, so here we have coordinate systems, right? So we have a three types of coordinate system. First one is our Cartesian coordinate system. This is our Cartesian coordinate system. Second is cylindrical coordinate system, and the third is spherical coordinate system. So to represent any point, because it is a 3D space, three dimensional, we will require three variables. So in Cartesian coordinate system, we have x, y, z, and in cylindrical coordinate system, rho, phi, z. Similarly, in spherical coordinate system, r, theta, phi. So what is these parameters? X, y, z is very simple. Everybody knows this Cartesian coordinate system. I will come in this cylindrical coordinate system. What is cylindrical coordinate system? In cylindrical coordinate system, rho is the radial distance. I will just plot it. Hope you can see the whiteboard. Are you able to see the whiteboard? Anyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so can you see I have written coordinate system? Can you see anyone? I have written here coordinate system in black ink.
No, sir.
Okay, wait, let me just change the presentation.
ओके सर।
होप नाउ यू कैन सी राइट। सो इन फर्स्ट कार्टेशियन कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम
यस सर।
वी हैव एक्स वी हैव वाई एंड जेड। इन सिलिंड्रिकल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम रो फाई एंड जेड। इन स्फेरिकल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम आर थीटा एंड फाई। कार्टेशियन कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम इज वेरी सिंपल। इफ वी हैव अ प्लेनर सिमेट्री देन वी हैव अ दिस देन दिस इज आवर जेड एक्सिस। सपोज दिस दिस इज एक्स दिस इज वाई देन यूज योर राइट हैंड एंड गो फ्रॉम एक्स टू वाई एक्स टू वाई। इफ यू यूज योर राइट हैंड एंड क्रॉस योर फिंगर्स फ्रॉम एक्स टू वाई then the thumb direction will give you the direction of z. Then the thumb direction will give you the direction of z. So if you go from x to y in this way, crossed fingers of your right hand, then this direction will give you the direction of z, the thumb direction. This will be your thumb direction, right? So this is our z direction. So in this way we calculate. So this is actually all the coordinate system follows this rule, right hand thumb rule. This is right hand thumb rule. X to Y, you will get Z in the direction of your thumb. Similarly, if this direction, if any direction, suppose in cylindrical coordinate system, this is a one line. This is one line, right? We have a one line. Then Z axis will be this axis. This axis will be the Z axis. This axis will be the z axis. And because every point, this point and this point, both are at equidistance from the cylinder, right? So this forms a cylindrical structure. Symmetry is around the cylinder, right? Right? So any point, suppose this point is there, then rho is this distance. Rho is this distance. This distance is rho. And if this is the origin, this is the origin, then this distance is z. This distance is z. So what remaining? The remaining is phi. How to calculate the phi? So phi is always calculated with respect to x-axis. So suppose this is our x-axis. I will write. This is our x-axis. This is our y-axis. And this is our z axis. And if this is the point, then this distance will be rho, right? And this distance on xz plane, this distance will be z. And this angle from x axis will be phi. This angle will be phi. This angle will be phi. Right, so this way we calculate rho phi z, and rho phi z will always follow the right hand thumb rule. Rho to phi, if you go, because now the phi see rho direction is this direction. This direction is rho direction, and what is the phi direction? Phi direction is like this. So now you cross your fingers from rho to phi. Rho to phi. You will get outward. The thumb will be outward. So that is the z axis. So this is your z axis, which is coming outward, right? So this way we say this follows also the right hand thumb rule. Similarly, r theta phi, the spherical coordinate system. In spherical coordinate system also, suppose we have any point, this point. This is the radial distance from the origin is r, right? There is a difference between r radial distance and rho. What is the difference? Rho is a radial distance from a line. So if you assume this point, this will be the rho. It is same, right? It is same for this point as well as this point. This is r. If you see, this is r. This is r. Similarly for this point, this is r, right? So this is the difference between r and rho. R is radial distance from the origin, and rho is the radial distance from the line. infinite line. That is our z axis. That is our z axis. So this is r. So what is theta? Theta is the inclination angle from z axis. So if this is your z axis, suppose this is your z axis, then whatever the angle, this angle, it will be theta. It will be theta. Right, this is theta. And phi, what is phi? Phi is same, whatever in this coordinate system, phi, these two quantities are same thing. Similarly, these two quantities are same thing. Z, whatever z is in this Cartesian coordinate system, same is in the cylindrical coordinate system. So z is same, z is not changing. So now we'll see the change when we move from when we move a little bit in the direction of x. Suppose the distance at this point is x and I am moving in this direction by a distance dx. How much change is there in the length? The change is how much? Only dx, right? Similarly, if the point is y and if I am moving in this direction by an amount dy, then what is the change in the length? The change in the length is this much, that is dy. Similarly, in the direction of z, what is the change? Dz. Right, if I am moving by a small amount dz, then change in the length will be dz. Suppose I am moving in x direction as well as in y direction, then there will be change of area. There will be change of area in the direction of x, the change is dx, the direction of y, the change is dy. What will be the total change? The total change will be an area. The area will be equal to dx into dy. Dx into dy, and length always have some direction, right? So the direction for this dx is dx ax, dy dz az, sorry, dz az, dz az. Similarly dy ay, right? So this is the direction of length in which direction is changing. Similarly, if there is any surface is there, surface always also is a vector quantity. What is the direction of the surface? Is perpendicular to that surface. So what is perpendicular to that surface? This surface. What is perpendicular to this surface? This surface is z, right? So the direction of this will be az, because surface always has a direction normal to the surface, normal to the plane of the surface. So if this is the surface, if this axis is x axis, this axis is y axis, then normal coming outward following right hand rule, so this will be the direction of our surface, that is az, right? So this way we calculate the direction of surface, any vector surface. Similarly, if I am moving in the direction of x by amount dx and simultaneously I am moving in the direction of z by dz, what will be the change in the area? The change in the area will be this much, like, so this is nothing but dx dz. And what is the direction of change? What is the direction of this surface? Ay. So here it will come ay. Similarly, here you can calculate, if I am moving in this direction dz, moving in this direction dy, then the change will be this area, and this area is nothing but dy dz ax. So this is the change in the surface area. So now we calculated this change in the surface area. Now so assume we are moving simultaneously in all the three direction, x, y and z. What you will get? You will get one cuboid, right? So I am moving in this direction also. And the change is, suppose, dz. In this direction, the change is dz. So this is a 3D space. It will contain some volume. So what will be the change in the volume? The change in the volume will be dx, dy, dz. And volume is a scalar quantity. There is no direction. So dx, dy, dz. So this will be our dv, right? dv, a small change in the volume. Similarly, you can calculate for other things also, like cylindrical coordinate system, spherical coordinate system. But there is a little bit difference in cylindrical coordinate system. So let me just explain you what is the difference here. In what happens in cylindrical coordinate system, suppose this is our x, this is our y, and because this suppose this is our any sorry this is our this is our any point and this point is represented by rho phi z and if I am moving in this direction by an amount d rho right so what is the change is d rho and what is the direction a rho the change is d rho and direction is a rho right but what happens when I move in this direction suppose this angle is d phi this angle is phi and I am moving by an angle d phi so what is this change what is the change in the length this is an arc this is not a straight line so the change in the arc will be the radius multiplied by the angle change rho d phi so if this length is rho then this change will be rho d phi a phi right rho d phi a phi z is same in Cartesian coordinate system as well as cylindrical coordinate system so it will remain dz az right so we have calculated the length change in the direction of rho in the direction of phi in the direction of z similarly if you want to calculate the change in the surface area in cylindrical coordinate system suppose we have this axis is z axis and this is our cylinder and because this axis is phi right this axis is phi because it is like this in circular motion this axis is z axis so rho so suppose I am moving in phi direction by an angle of d phi so suppose this angle is d phi if the angle is d phi what will be the length change and I am also moving in the direction of z so I am moving in the direction of z by an amount dz suppose this is dz and I am moving by an angle of phi if I am moving by an angle of d phi then what will be the length change rho d phi so what will be the area change area will be equal to rho d phi dz and what will be the direction will be perpendicular to this surface and perpendicular to this surface is nothing but rho because these all three quantities are mutually perpendicular to each other this property known as orthonormal means ax cross ay equal to az similarly ay cross az equal to ax similarly in cylindrical coordinate system you can also write a rho cross a phi will be equal to az a theta cross a phi will be equal to ar similarly you can write a phi cross ar equal to a theta so this is known as orthonormality when you do the cross product of any two vectors following the right hand rule you will get the another vector the third vector it will follow the right hand rule if you cross product of y and x ay cross ax then you will get minus az not plus az here you will get minus az because it is not following the right hand rule right so y cross z is x but y cross x will be equal to minus z so this is the orthonormal so it always follow orthogonal and orthonormal and it follows the right hand rule so this is all about the coordinate system so similarly also you can also see the spherical coordinate system also so what will be the area change and volume change also you can see if we are moving in the direction of d rho also then there will be a volume change will be equal to volume you can write it will be equal to rho d phi dz d rho this much volume change Similarly, in spherical coordinate system, if you see spherical coordinate system, in spherical coordinate system, what happens? The change will be depending on, see, the spherical coordinate system. This is nothing but angle theta. Right? This angle is theta. If this angle is theta, then what is the change in the length r d theta? Because r is this angle, right? R is this angle, right? So this is the change in the direction of theta. Similarly, you can calculate the change in the direction of phi. Phi is same, right? But you have to represent the phi in terms of r instead of rho, right? So suppose this is our z axis. So this is the circle. At this particular point, and this is the origin. And suppose I am moving in this direction, and this direction is nothing but phi, right? And suppose the change is d phi. Suppose this change is what? D phi. But what will be the length change? This is an arc again. So the length change will be this distance multiplied by this angle, right? So first you need to calculate what is this. This is nothing but the radius of this circle. And this radius is not, this distance is what? This distance is r. This distance is what? This angle is theta. This is nothing but the vertical component of this. So this is nothing but equal to r sine theta. And it is nothing but equal to rho. So what will be this change in this phi direction? This radius, which is equal to this radius, because this is a circle. So this radius and this will be equal. So the change will be in the direction of phi. The change will be equal to r sine theta d phi a phi. This will be the change in the direction of phi, right? Similarly, you can calculate the change in the direction of rho, r. In the direction of r, the change is only dr ar, nothing else. So if you want to calculate the area change in any particular direction, you just need to multiply this and dr. If you want to calculate the change in r and phi plane, if you want to calculate the change in theta and phi plane, then you need to multiply according. So this is all about the coordinate system. I will just tell you that the coordinate system is like this. Let me just show you the notes again. So what is happening? We have a coordinate system x, y, z, rho, phi, z, r, theta, phi. So this is Cartesian, cylindrical, spherical. So what we are doing, we are just removing this x, y, z or x, rho, r with the value this u, v, w. We are representing it with respect to u, v, w. And whatever the scaling factor that we have seen, r, rho, sine, theta, something like that. So we have represented those scaling factor with this, h1, h2, h3. So when we talk about the Cartesian coordinate system, we have only 1, 1, 1. Because there is no scaling factor. When we talk about cylindrical coordinate system, rho d phi. In the direction of phi, the change was rho d phi. So there is one scaling factor. This comes rho. Similarly, when we talk about r theta phi, the change in the direction of theta is r d theta. So there is a scaling factor r. When we talk about phi, the change is r sine theta d phi. So there is a scaling factor r sine theta. So this is all about the length change, the area change, and the volume change. You just need to multiply it with h1, h2, h3. h1 du, au, h2 dv, av, h3 dw, aw. So you just need to represent this coordinate system using this. So this is all about the coordinate system. So there is also a way to transform one coordinate system to the another coordinate system. This you can see just the Cartesian to cylindrical, Cartesian to spherical, Cartesian to spherical or cylindrical or something like that. You can also do the transformation. So this is all about the coordinate system. The next is the vector calculus. In the vector calculus, we will study one very important quantity. Very important quantity, that is a vector special derivative operator. Vector special derivative operator. It's very important quantity in this vector special derivative operator. In this, let me just share my whiteboard. Yes, again. Yes. So vector calculus. Now we'll see the vector calculus. It's very important. Vector calculus. So here we will study one operator that is known as del. Del. This operator del. This tells you the rate of change of any space varying quantity. Any space varying quantity along with the direction of change. It will give you the space any. So del. What is del? Del is nothing but curl by curl u au. I am writing in general coordinate systems, not x y z. I am writing in general coordinate system. Curl by curl. Actually, let me just write first in the Cartesian coordinate system. Will be easy for you to understand. Okay, so curl by curl x ax, curl by curl y ay, curl by curl z az. So this is the special derivative operator. This will give you the rate of change with respect to x, rate of change of that quantity with respect to y, rate of change of that quantity with respect to z, along with the direction of change ax, ay, az, right? So this is a special vector derivative operator. It is used to know the rate of change of any space varying quantity. So this can be applied to scalar quantity as well as vector quantity. When we apply to scalar quantity, it becomes, suppose any function, it is a scalar function. It is any scalar function. When we apply this quantity to any scalar function, it becomes gradient. It becomes gradient. Gradient. And you just need to write here f. If it is a scalar function of x, y, z, something like that. So this is a vector quantity, right? This is a vector quantity. So gradient is a vector quantity. Vector quantity. Similarly, this can be also applied to any vector quantity. Any vector quantity, suppose f is any vector. Then we can apply del using two operators. Dot operator. If we apply dot operator, it is nothing but divergence. Divergence of vector quantity. And divergence is a dot product, right? Dot product means f is nothing but f1 ax, f2 ay, f3 ay. Now you do this dot product of del with this quantity. What will you get? You will get just, I will show you in the notes. And now I will just tell you, just you just need to actually multiply, and it will be a scalar quantity. It will be a scalar quantity. It will be a scalar quantity. Similarly, del can also be applied by cross product. This is known as curl. This is known as curl of f. Curl of f. So this is all about the vector quantity, and there are some vector identity, vector identities. This you should remember. These are very important. Del cross del f. Del cross del. See, this is a gradient. Then you are taking curl. Del cross del. Whenever you take cross product, A cross B, this is nothing but A B sine theta, right? When you take dot product, it is nothing but A B cos theta, right? When what is theta? Theta is the angle between A and B vector. Now these two vectors are same, del cross del. It means the angle is zero, right? So this quantity must be zero. So this is first vector identity. Similarly, second, del dot del cross A, any vector, del dot del cross A. So what is the answer of this? Because del cross A, any quantity which is A cross B is equal to C. C will always be perpendicular to A and B. C will always be perpendicular to A and B. So it means whatever the answer for this del cross A, suppose any other vector F, then this vector will be perpendicular to del, right? And when you do the dot product of this with f, it will be a zero because the angle is 90 degree. AB cos theta, cos is 90. So it means this is another quantity, vector identity, that is zero. So whenever you do the cross dot product of this del dot del cross A, it will always be zero. Similarly, there is one vector identity formula that you should remember is del cross it from gate point of view. I am telling this del cross A. This is equal to del del dot A minus del square A. This is a very important formula that you should remember. This is a third formula that you should remember. So let me just share my screen now again. Okay, so yes, so this is a first is a gradient. This is a gradient formula, but here you need to account this h1 h2 scaling factor. So this is a very simple formula. Whenever you take a gradient, it will change, it will tell you the change in the quantity, rate of change in the quantity in particular direction. So it is written in a general form. You can just replace u with x, v with y, w with z. H1, H2, H3 are the scaling factors corresponding to Cartesian coordinate system. Similarly, if you want to write this equation in terms of cylindrical coordinate system, you need to replace u with rho, v with phi, w with z, H1 with 1, H2, rho, H3, 1. So you need to just see this table. 1, 1, 1, 1 rho, 1, 1 r sine theta, like that way. So you just need to replace u with r, v with theta, w with phi. Similarly, h1 with 1, h2 with r, h3 with r sine theta. So that way you can just calculate the formula for all the three coordinate system. Similarly, this is the formula for the divergence. This is a very simple formula, 1 upon h1, h2, h3. When the, all the three scaling factor will be multiplied, then curl by curl u, curl by curl u, and there will be h2, h3. Here you can see H2, H3, H1 is not there. And in the second, H2 will not be there. In the third vector, H3 will not be there. So whenever you take AU, then H1 will not be there. Whenever you take AV, then H2 will not be there. Whenever you take AW, H3 will not be there. So this is the formula for the divergence. Similarly, this is the formula for the curl, curl of any vector quantity, H1 AU, H2 AV, H3 W. Curl by curl U, curl by curl V, curl by curl W. H1 AU, H2 AV, and H3 AW. So this is the formula for curl of any vector quantity. So this, in this way, you can calculate the curl, right? So there is one operator, another operator, del dot del V. That is a Laplacian operator. This is the Laplacian operator. That is del dot del V, del square V. So this is also known as divergence of a gradient of a scalar quantity, divergence of del V. Because there is a dot here, right? So del square V is equal to del dot del V. You just need to apply the above two formulas. This del V formula, the first formula, and the second formula. You need to combine these two formulas. So when you combine two formulas, in place of AU, in place of AU, you need to put this in place of AU. In place of AU, you need to put first value. In place of AV, you need to put this. In place of W, you need to put this. So if you put this, you will get this. Del square V is equal to del dot del V. H2, H3, if you see 1 upon H1, 1 upon H1, curl V by curl U. 1 upon H1, here you can see. 1 upon H1, this is H1. Curl V by curl U. So similarly, you can calculate the other things also. Vector identity is already studied. So now we'll come to the basics of electrostatics. Basics of electrostatics. So first I will show you the basics. In the basics, I will tell you that electrostatics. So let me just write electrostatic. And here magnetostatics. We will study these two things parallelly, electrostatics, magnetostatics. Statics term is coming means there is no change with respect to time. We are assuming time is not varying. Static means time is not varying, right? So in electric field, electrostatic, when there is a charge, charge is present, any charge is present, then there will always be charge accumulate. When charge accumulate, it means it's a voltage, right? When charge accumulate means there is a potential difference or voltage is there. And because of that, there will be electric field. And you can say it is an electric field intensity, and its unit is coulomb, its unit is volt per meter. Similarly, in magnetostatic, when charge moves, that is a current. When charge moves, here the charge is static, it is not moving. Here the charge will move. When the charge moves with a constant velocity, then there will be some current, or you can say I is equal to rate of change of charge dq by dt. Then there will be some magnetic field, and its unit will be ampere per meter. Its unit is ampere. What is the unit of voltage? Because what is the unit of voltage? Volt. So the electric field unit is volt per meter. What is the unit of current? Ampere. So that's why the magnetic field unit is ampere per meter. It's very similar, right? So there is an analogy between these two things, right? So this static charge will always produce a force on the static charges. Only this in electric field, the force will be experienced by only the static charges. Only the static charges. And in the magnetostatics, force will be experienced by only the charges which are moving. Q, V cross B. So if V is zero, if the charge is not moving, this force will be zero. So this is the force for in electrostatic, this is the force in magnetostatic, right? So here B is a magnetic flux density. Magnetic flux density. We will calculate the relation between magnetic flux density and the magnetic field intensity. First, we'll see here the charge is static. Here the charge is static. Here the charge moving with constant velocity. Constant velocity. So if the charge is static, there is an electric field. If charge is moving with constant velocity, magnetic field. So when the charge moves with acceleration means velocity is not constant, non-uniform velocity. Then it will produce both the fields E as well as H. That is known as electromagnetic wave. E and H both will be produced. So this is for the time varying actually, because the acceleration means your velocity is non-uniform, right? So now we'll see this electric field, right? So the unit of electric field is already said volt per meter. This is ampere per meter. So there is a one quantity that is D. This is the electric flux density. Electric flux density. It is equal to electric flux. Whenever the density term comes, it means per meter square. So it is nothing but charge, or you can say flux per unit area. So you can say its unit will be coulomb per meter square. Similarly here B is magnetic flux density. Its unit will be equal to Weber per meter square. Weber per meter square, where Weber is the unit of magnetic flux. Magnetic flux. And generally we represent coulomb with electric flux. Electric flux or charge, right? Or charge. So there is one quantity in electric field, epsilon, that is known as permittivity. Because it is related to the electric field, its unit is farad per meter. Here there is a mu, permeability. permeability, its unit is ampere, sorry, Henry per meter, because it is related to our inductance. This is related to capacitor, because capacitor stores the charge in the form of electric field, inductor in the form of kinetic energy, that is magnetic field. Henry per meter, its unit is Henry per meter. So now we will calculate the relation between D, E, B and H. Suppose we have, because we know very simple formula, Q is equal to C cross V, right? We know this formula, Q is equal to C cross V. So just you need to divide it per meter square. What is the unit of Q? This is coulomb. What is the unit of C? Farad. What is the unit of V? Volt, right? So you just need to divide it by per meter square. Per meter. So what is coulomb per meter square? This is nothing but D. What is Farad per meter square? This is nothing but epsilon or epsilon naught. Or into what is volt per meter? E. So D is equal to epsilon E. Similarly, we can calculate the relation between B and H using this formula. Psi is equal to Li, flux, magnetic flux is equal to inductance into the total current. Here you will get B is equal to mu H. B is equal to mu H. So this is all the basics of electrostatics. Now we'll study some Maxwell's equations. We'll come to the Maxwell equation. First we will study, because we have not studied the time varying, so we'll study the Maxwell equation for static field. Then we'll move to the time varying field in the next lecture. The first is the Gaussian law. In the Maxwell equation we have a Gaussian law. Sorry, let me just take it again. Yeah. Maxwell's equation for Maxwell equations for static field. First is Gaussian law. Gaussian law says, according to the Gaussian law, the closed surface integral of electric flux density, this is the closed, this circle denotes the closed surface, is equal to the charge present inside the closed surface. Suppose I have any closed surface. This is a closed surface, it's a 3D closed surface. Inside that there is a charge Q. Then what is this D? This is D is electric flux density. Flux density means flux per unit area. So whatever the flux is coming out of this closed surface, it will be equal to the charge present in the closed surface. Because we are multiplying it with area, so electric flux, this is electric flux density, we are multiplying it with the area, so it will become electric flux, right? So whatever the electric flux is coming out of this closed surface, it will depend on the charge inside the closed surface. Suppose there is a total charge minus Q plus Q, then what is the total charge inside this closed surface? The total charge inside this closed surface is zero, so this will be zero. This will be zero. But if there is no minus charge here, if there is no minus charge here, then this will be equal to Q, right? So this is the Gaussian law. This is the Gaussian law in integral form. So to convert into, this is the integral form here, because, so this is not that Gaussian law. This is not the Gaussian law. This is not the Gaussian law. Because here this is not closed. This is not closed surface. This is an open surface. Suppose this is Q, then the flux is going like this way. So the flux is cutting through this surface. So this is not equal to the total charge, because flux is going this direction also. This direction also. So until and unless you take the closed surface, you cannot write like this way. So this is not the Gaussian law, right? this is not equal to q. Gaussian law is this. So to convert this into the point form or the differential form, we use two theorems, the Stokes theorem and the divergence theorem. First we will study the divergence theorem. Divergence theorem says you can convert any closed surface integral into volume integral, because any closed surface will have some volume, right? Any closed surface will have some volume. So you can convert a surface integral into volume integral using the divergence theorem, just by taking its divergence like this. So now you can just write, like, apply this theorem. In the left hand side you will have this, and in the right hand side it is a charge. This is a total charge. Suppose the charge density is rho v coulomb per meter cube. The charge is distributed. Instead of a particular point, it is distributed. Then here we will write the triple integral. The total charge will be equal to this, right? So you will get this. So this is the Maxwell first equation, that is the Gaussian law in point form. This is the differential form. This is all. So del dot d is divergence of d. So divergence means whatever is coming outside, it will depend on the value of rho v. So whatever this inside there is, if the charge is distributed and the charge density is rho v, then the electric flux will depend on this equation rho v, right? So this is all about the Gaussian law. The second equation is the nature of the second equation is nature of electric field. This is all about static, right? So nature of electric field is, electric field always starts from one point and it ends at another point. Suppose there is a plus q charge, so electric field will be like this. It will go away from this, and where it will end? If there is no negative charge, then it will end at infinity. But if there is some negative charge, suppose this is a negative charge here, this is a positive charge, this is a negative charge. So now the electric field will be like this. So it will start from positive charge and it will end from negative charge. It will end at negative charge, like this way. So this, so nature of electric field is, it is not circular. If any quantity which is not circular, then the curl of that will be equal to zero. So this is the Maxwell's second equation. If any quantity which is not circular, electric field is not circular, right? It is not curly in nature. Curl means circular in nature. It is not like that. It starts from one point and end at another point. So electric field is not curly in nature. So this del cross E is equal to zero. So this is the Maxwell second equation in point form or differential form. Similarly, you can calculate that if its integral form just by using the Stokes theorem. What Stokes theorem is? Stokes theorem says you can convert any line integral into a surface value using curl, open surface. See, any closed line, this is a closed line, this circle is a closed line, so it will contain some area, right? So we can represent it as open surface, because this is an open surface, right? So this formula we are, this theorem we are going to use to calculate the integral form. So we can take the double integral on both sides of this. So if you take the double integral, the left hand side will become del cross E ds equal to zero. So this is, using Stokes theorem, you can write E dot dl equal to zero. E dot dl is equal to zero. And this is nothing but the KVL in network theorem. What is the unit of this? Volt per meter. What is the unit of this? Meter. This is nothing but volt. Summation of all the voltages in a closed loop, because this is a closed loop, equal to zero. This is not the Maxwell equation. This is not the Maxwell equation, because this is not closed here. It should be closed to have a Maxwell equation. So this is a Maxwell second equation. मैक्सवेल थर्ड इक्वेशन इज नेचर ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. नेचर ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड, नेचर ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इज व्हाट? मैग्नेटिक फील्ड ऑलवेज फॉर्म्स ए लूप, ऑलवेज फॉर्म्स ए लूप. लाइक इफ 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 सपोज वी हैव वन करंट कैरिंग वायर, देन ए मैग्नेटिक फील्ड विल बी अराउंड दिस, अराउंड दिस, इट विल बी अराउंड लाइक दिस. एंड द डायरेक्शन ऑफ द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड, डायरेक्शन ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड, of magnetic field will be given by the direction of current. It this formula is very important, very important. Direction of current multiply the radial direction, the radial direction from, so just a second. So you can always write the direction. So you can also use a right hand thumb rule also. Just use your right hand and keep your thumb along the direction of current. Keep your thumb along the direction of current. Right hand rule. First I will, let me tell you the right hand rule. Right hand rule is easy to calculate the direction of magnetic. Right hand rule. Thumb direction is direction of current, and the crossed finger will give you the direction of magnetic field. So in this, if you use your right hand and point your thumb towards the direction of current, then this direction will be the direction of magnetic field. This direction will be the direction of magnetic. A magnetic field is always circular in nature, always circular in nature. And if you don't want to use this right hand thumb rule, you can also use this formula. Direction of magnetic field is equal to the direction of the current multiplied by the radial direction from current to the point, to that point. So suppose this is the current. I want to calculate the magnetic field direction at this point. What you will do? You just need to multiply. Suppose this direction is Z. This direction is, suppose any particular direction. This direction is, suppose this direction is X. Then the direction of magnetic field intensity will be nothing but equal to D. It will be equal to Z, direction of current, multiplied by X, and Z cross X is nothing but Y. So the direction of magnetic field intensity will be the direction Y direction. So this way you can also calculate, or you can also apply the right hand thumb rule. Z cross X will always be Y. So what this nature of magnetic field is, it is always circular in nature, circular. And if it is circular, it means it is not divergent. It is not divergent. Divergent means it is not coming out of some box. It is always circular. It is starting from one point and ending at the same point, meeting at the same point, right? So it is circular in nature. So if it is circular in nature, it will not be diverging in nature. If something is not divergent, it means it is a solenoidal vector. It is solenoidal vector. And solenoidal vector is nothing but del dot of that quantity should be equal to zero. So this is the nature of the magnetic field. And you use the divergence theorem, take volume integral and write this, then you will get B dot ds equal to zero. This is the Maxwell third equation in integral form. Next equation is the last equation, Maxwell fourth equation. This is given by actually from Ampere's law, or you can say Ampere's circuital law. What Ampere's circuital law says? Ampere's circuital law says the closed line integral of magnetic field intensity is equal to the current enclosed by that closed open surface. Suppose this is the current I, then the closed line integral of this magnetic field intensity is this, right? This is magnetic field. So the closed line integral, the closed line integral of this will be equal to the current passing through this surface, whatever the current. Suppose this current is I, this current is 2I, and we have a closed surface, closed line is this. This is the closed line. So what will be this answer? This answer will be equal to minus I, because the net current in this open surface is equal to, if you assume this is the direction of magnetic field, if you assume this is the direction of magnetic field, then this direction is H. If you use your right hand thumb, because of this current, magnetic field will be in this direction. Because of this current, magnetic field will be in this direction. But the given magnetic field is in this direction, right? In this direction, corresponding to this. So what will be the net current inside this closed surface will be equal to, this will be taken as a positive, this will be taken as a negative. So the net current will be equal to I minus 2I is equal to minus I. So the closed line integral of magnetic field intensity for this question will be equal to minus I. Suppose this is a loop. There is one current of I ampere, another current of 3I. But there is a cross here. It is dot means coming outward, cross means coming inward, but the direction of magnetic field intensity is given like this. The direction is given like this. So if you use your right hand, this direction of magnetic field is following this current and it is opposing this current. So again, the answer will be I minus 3I equal to minus 2I. So the answer will be equal to minus 2I. Similarly, if you have one loop here and the direction of magnetic field is this, this is the direction of magnetic field, and this is equal to I, this is equal to 4I, then the answer will be equal to, because now the magnetic field direction is given with respect to this current, right? So this will be taken as a positive, this will be taken as a negative. So the closed line integral of magnetic field intensity will be is equal to 4I minus I equal to 3I. So this will be the answer, right? So this is how we apply the Maxwell equation to this question. So this is the integral form. Similarly, you can calculate the differential form by applying the Stokes theorem. You just need to apply the Stokes theorem. You will get the value of this del cross H equal to J. So this is the, after applying the Stokes theorem, if you apply the Stokes theorem, you will get this. So this is the Stokes theorem. So again, this is not Maxwell equation. This is not Maxwell equation because this is not closed. Even in third equation also. In third equation also, where is this? Yeah, so this is the third equation, right? In this equation also, this is not equal to zero, because here it is not closed. This surface is not closed. This will be equal to some magnetic flux. This will not be equal to zero, because if the surface is open, then the flux is cutting through this, right? But if the surface is closed, then whatever the flux is entering in this, it is also leaving. So the net flux leaving will be equal to zero. So this means net flux leaving through a closed surface equal to zero. This is the Maxwell third equation. So this is all about the Maxwell's equations in the static field, right? So I think the time is over. We will start at 1:30. We'll meet here and we'll start from here again, the Maxwell equations. If you have any doubts, you can ask. Hello, Snehal ma'am, are you there?
Yes sir. Hello.
Yes ma'am.
Hello.
Yes ma'am, I can hear. Yes.
Sir.
So.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. I'll send you the next lecture link. The separate link I'll send you,
okay,
sir.
Okay, ma'am. Sure. So I will share the notes with you. You can distribute the notes to the students after that.
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you.
Any doubts from the students?
No, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
No, sir. Thank you.
Okay. We'll meet you in the next lecture. Okay.
Hello,
ma'am.
Yes, next lecture will be at 1:30 p.m. sharp. Okay, तो मुझे फिर से कॉल करने की जरूरत नहीं पड़नी चाहिए. सब लोग फास्ट जैसे ही लिंक डालती हूँ मैं, वैसे ज्वाइन हो जाना. थैंक यू.